some rugby match going on in Tricastle. Which I know has made some of the transport a bit difficult and so on. So it's great to see such a good crowd. I'm Nick Grant, the Vice Principal here, and I have the pleasure to introduce Tony Travers in 1 second. Before that, I thought you might just like to understand a little bit about why this is called a penny lecture and why we only charge you a penny to get in. And that is because Morley College owes its origins to penny lectures. These were a series of lectures set up at the Old Vic Theatre, which they sort of formed the Old Vic's outreach education programme, we call it, in this day and age. And those lectures were terribly popular. They got sort of crowds of 800, 900 people coming along. There was no television there, of course. They've evolved over the years into lecture series and then into classes and courses. And eventually there was a critical mass large enough to justify a college. And the evolved Morley College appeared. And first of all, in the back rooms and under the stage of the Old Vic Theatre, and eventually moving into this site in the 1920s. Last year was our 125th anniversary, which gives me an opportunity to plug a book. Sorry. It's usually our speakers are plugging books. I'm plugging a book, do afterwards have a look at our illustrated history of Morley, and if you want to know more about us, if you know us, then please buy one. So this is the first of our penny lectures series for 2015-2016, and we're really pleased to be doing this in conjunction with Lambeth Archives as part of Lambeth Heritage Month. So thank you very much for then your help and John's in facilitating Tony's presence here today, and for what is a fantastic exhibition over in our gallery. So if you're interested in Lambeth and you haven't yet visited our exhibition, which is called Lambeth Water, I'm not going to tell you anymore, you have to go and see it. But if you're interested in Lambeth's history, then go and please see it. It's a great exhibition, and you'll see all sorts of materials that you will find fascinating and aren't usually on public show.
Is it open after the lecture?
Sadly not, I'm afraid. No, sadly not. I think the gallery staff at the rugby tonight. But it is open. If you look on our website, it tells you when it's open. So do please try and come along to that. There are also various other events happening in Lambeth Heritage Month, which again, if you Google in Lambeth Heritage, you'll get a full report on that. So it now comes to me to stop rambling and waffling and to introduce Tony Travers, who's a professor at London School of Economics. He's an expert in local government, local finance in particular. I got his profile off of the thing, it's too long to go into now, but he's advised government and parliament, he's on this research board, that research board, he's a journalist and writes regularly for the broadsheets, appears on the television, the list goes on and on. So it's a real privilege to be able to have Tony in Morley today. Thank you, Tony, for coming, and give him a Morley welcome.
Is to talk about Lambeth as part of the 32 plus the city 33 local authority makeup of London. I mean, London is one of the great world cities, has been for a very long time, in fact. But it's also, well, more than 33 separate places. If you live in Lambeth or Southwark or Wandsworth, you will know that within those areas lie many other areas, and within those areas lie neighbourhoods, and within them housing estates, or whatever, streets. So London is a complicated place. I've never been as comfortable as some people describing London as a city of villages, though it is true when you get further out into the outer boroughs. There are places like Pinner that are real villages, there's no question about that. I think it's more complicated. Some of them are villages, some of them are communities, some of them are estates, some of them are this, some of them are that, some of the streets, some of them are just communities dispersed across the city because we've all got something in interest with it, in common with each other. So what I want to do is to unravel why we've ended up with this particular form of government in London, why it is the London Borough of Lambeth or the London Borough of Suffolk is what it is, rather than us living as we might do if we were in New York and think about this. New York is a city with the same population, very similar economy, but just one city government really, just City Hall. There are boroughs in New York, but they don't do very much. They are relatively weak compared to our boroughs. So that would be a very different kind of world. We all had just one, the mayor was the only thing there was. It's much more difficult to get attention, and arguably the city would be more governed from the centre for the centre. And the way we've done it gives a voice to people in Lambeth and Southwark, a voice to people living in Harrow and in Haybury. Anyway, when you think about the beginning, it is 50 years to this year that London boroughs began in their current form. And what I want to do, and I'm afraid we're going to go back to the Romans briefly, is explain how we got here. Now, so I'm going to begin with 1965, which was a remarkable year for London. In the late January of that year, Sir Winston Churchill's funeral took place at St Paul's Cathedral. In March, Herbert Morrison, son of South London, the legendary leader of the London County Council, based at County Hall, he had died, and that year he too had been a member of Churchill's War Cabinet. In June, it was the 700th anniversary of Parliament, and later in the year, about a month from now, actually, the Telecom Tower, BT, Post Office Tower, as it was then called, opened, as a sort of sign of modernity, the white heat of technology, and Anthony Wedgwood's Ben, and all of that. I won't pause and actually really bend the minds of modern politics, but let's keep going. So, 1965 was a year in which a reform was made to London government, which has affected the city ever since. After many years of debate in the Royal Commission, London, that is the built-up area of London, 1,500 square kilometres, 650 square miles, became London, embracing the whole of Middlesex, parts of Kent, Essex, Surrey and Hertfordshire as well. And on the 1st of April, today's 32 boroughs and the Greater London Council took charge of the capital's government. And at the same time, the London County Council, the metropolitan boroughs, we've been hearing one of them, and a substantial number of districts outside the London area were abolished to create new authorities. Now, this is a country which regularly has local government reorganisations. It's unusual. If we lived in Germany or France or America, this would happen less. But they happen often here. 50 years is therefore a very long time. And at 50 years old, Lambeth Council or Southwark Council or Wandsworth Council are actually pretty old by the standards of British government institutions. And so it's very important to remember that GLC, after all, survived only 21 years. The Inner London Education Authority, which had been a vestige of the London School Board, was swept away in 1990. Whitehall Department of Government was a government office for London, briefly, that came and went. The NHS has been much reorganised. Of course, there is one heroic exception to all of this, and that is the City of London Corporation. It's an exception to all rules. It's existed continuously since before 1066. It makes Lambeth and Wandsworth and Southwark seem real newcomers. And its history is unique. Although since 1965, to the fairness of the city, it has played an important role along with the boroughs, as if it were a borough, but also with its own distinct functions. Now, the borough's 50 years included a series of distinct periods. In the early years, there were massive housing and road schemes, some of which are the housing schemes very near to the building we're in at the moment. They were undertaken at a time when London's population was falling. People thought cities were dying at that time. So I'll say a little bit more about that in November. In the 80s, relationships between many London local authorities and the government were, to put it gently, strained by ideology and radicalism, both at the Whitehall national level and also at the borough level, and nowhere more so than in Lambeth. In 2000, a completely new system of government was introduced. After the GLC had gone, a mayor and assembly, not directly elected, a very American form of government, introduced. And since then, of course, but not because of that, we've seen a rapid period of growth when the city's gone from being a place in decline to one that is growing very sharply. Now, despite all of this, I would argue London today is still recognisable as the city of 1965, but it's also remarkably different. The city's historic strength, I think, has proved to be a capacity to accommodate the new without destroying the old. This building itself, sort of model, sort of part. Part of both in some ways. It's clearly a 1950s building, quite old, and yet it's fulfilling a modern function we're all here tonight. So London's particular form of government is unique. There are no other times in most city governments are actually unique, so this is not quite as exciting a remark as it sounds. But London is particularly unusual. I'll come back to why in a moment. And I think the uniqueness owes much to what I would call it being a bottom-heavy two-tier system. So we have a two-level system of government in this city. But if you add up the power of the boroughs together, they have more power than the mayor. That's a very unusual form of government. That means that individual boroughs aren't as powerful as the mayor, but collectively, in the end, they can be. And indeed, you could argue it's the boroughs that source the GLC, at least some of them. So it's a city today where the mayor has extraordinary powers over transport, policing, fire and emergencies, planning and housing, but the boroughs collectively spend twice as much. They have responsibilities for education, social care, public health, highways, environmental services, and even some housing still. And in assessing the system, I think it's necessary to understand the origins of all of this, and that's why we're going to visit the Romans briefly. Because the origins of London's contemporary system of borough government lie 2,000 years ago. The Romans' decision to create a settlement on a site close to today's Tower Bridge, that they did pause briefly for reinforcements in Southwark, I remember, determined for all time the location of a city which grew from Londinium into London. What have the Romans ever done for us? Well, they located their main British town at a point where it was relatively easy to cross a river, which also provided good access to the sea. You look at the City of London, that's what it did. It's just easy to cross the river there and get access to the sea. And in doing so, they not only built an urban settlement, but they made it possible to develop ship-borne trade. So when we talk about London as being a mercantile city, it's very much for this reason. Now, the Romans left in 410 AD. All school children learned that. And then by 450 or 460, English history descends into, nothing really. It's not written down. Very difficult for historians, not that I'm a historian, I should add. And therefore, what we discover next is the Anglo-Saxons and their recorded history, and King Alfred, he of the cakes, not sure that's true or not, but anyway, let's just assume it was, re-established London and attempted, though with little success, to impose a grid plan on the streets of London. He wanted a grid. And the establishment of the city's own government during the Anglo-Saxon settlement of England put in place the first building block of today's system of London government. That's the city. Anglo-Saxon monarchs also established Westminster Abbey, and Westminster Whitehall has become the centre of national government since the 11th century, and has remained separate from the government of the city itself, in the city. And that started a split, which you can still see today. Business in the city, self-governing, the business of national government of Westminster, the church, about a mile and a half away along the Strand. So that's something that's set in time, for all time, a difference you can still see today. The City of London dates its earliest origins from around this point. And because the city's evolution comes to determine so much else about London and its government, these early stages can be seen as hugely important in setting the scene for subsequent developments during the Norman, Plantagenet, Tudor, Georgian, and Victorian period. William the Conqueror decided to leave the city alone. He granted it a charter to guarantee its freedoms. The Tower of London, which is actually in Tower Hamlets, not in the city, was built to keep an eagle eye out over the merchants of the city, whom King William wanted to tax, but generally to leave alone. And the city was quite happy with that. Now, between the 11th and 15th centuries, historians recall that the City of London developed many of the livery companies and guilds which became the backbone of its city of government. The office of mayor was initiated in 1189, and that allowed Dick Whittington, symbol of London ambition and resilience, to become the Lord Mayor in 1397. However, the city was beginning to spread out from the square mile, as we call it today. It began to spread. And Queen Elizabeth I was so concerned with the sprawl of the city that her government attempted to prohibit further development by the imposition of an early green belt. Now, the green belt, of course, would have been sort of here. So you can see how successful that was. But still, she did try. The other thing that happened at this time is that several bills of mortality were introduced by the monarch, by the government, to monitor deaths around London for good reasons. There were plagues and things at that time, to monitor public health. And the parishes that were covered by these bills of mortality, so the area around London covered, became the basis of the area which in 1855 was where the Metropolitan Board of Works was set up, and I'll say a bit more about that in a moment, and subsequently the London County Council and today's Inner London. So this area would have been reporting, as with its neighbours in Southwark and Wandsworth, would have been reporting on bills of mortality. Now, by the time of Elizabeth's death in 1603, London had spread beyond the city and neighbouring Westminster ill directions. And her government's restrictions on development had little effect on the sprawl. What happens at this point, of course, and everybody knows this, is that new players come into this story, and they are the aristocratic estates. A number of families owned land between the city and Westminster and began to develop housing in places such as today's Covent Garden, Mayfair, and Belgravia. These developments didn't, of course, require planning permission. Farmers or existing aristocratic owners gave or presumably were encouraged to give the land to the aristocracy, and they then built beautiful squares on them in places like Covent Garden. And this created an area of elegant squares and streets, which you can still see today. And from this point onwards, the great city sprawls out across fields that would today be Maryland, Soho, Fitzrovia, where I live, North Lambeth, and Marble Arch and beyond. But London's government didn't expand to follow the city's growth. And the reason for that is the City of London governed itself according to its historic traditions, and outside the ancient jurisdiction of the City of London, what we have was shire counties, Kent, Surrey, and so on, and parish-based government. Many of the parishes here in Lambeth will have names which at one point were involved with city government, can you believe it? Because they and their vestries were where micro-government sprung up as the city grew. Now, by the start of the 19th century, there was self-evidently a problem with the way London governed itself. There was a set of municipal corporations commissioners who reported in 1837 that there should be a single metropolitan municipality which would inevitably have consumed the city. This proposal was given short shrift by the Corporation of London, who wished to protect its ancient self-government and privileges. And as a result, the growing urban area continued to be governed by county and parish-based authorities, and increasingly ad hoc boards and private companies, for example, delivering water, came to have a role in delivering paving, lighting, water, and other services. Now, an academic called John Davis has written a brilliant book about this period called Reforming London, The London Government Problem, 1855 to 1900. The name, as they say, is in the title. The complexities of the parishes, their vestries, and the parliamentary efforts to reform London's government are a remarkable tale of very local vested interests fighting to preserve their autonomy and their tiny area of government. So it isn't just the city, by now the parishes that have sprung up in this urban sprawl, including ones right in here, become their own self-interest. They want to defend their own position against reform. Now, the focus of government in the city, which was now a big city, was about a million or more people by the middle of the 19th century. The problems of government became so bad because of the filthy condition of the river. Parliament found itself unable to meet on Thames side rooms. That's how bad it got. The river was so smelly, so disgusting, I think it actually caught fire on occasion, which is never a good sign for the river. that you couldn't be there. And so this great stink, as it was called, and successive cholera epidemics convinced the government, national government, to create a type of citywide government for London. And this was the first one of its kind, invented in 1855, the Metropolitan Board of Works. Now, its name sounds a bit kind of clunky, and it was. It was a joint committee of all the city and all these parishes and vestries, deliberately designed to be a bit weak. The board and its chief engineer, a most important person in the history of London, Sir Joseph Bassalgett, whose descendant currently chairs the Arts Council, managed to deliver one of the world's most advanced sewage systems, which will still be operating under us tonight. Brilliant system, brick built, using gravity, very ecologically friendly. And he also managed to build a number of road improvements, including the embankments, and even introduced a fire brigade. Police tried to introduce a fire brigade, but the government decided they'd give it to the Board of Works. Board of Works was a distinctive kind of institution, so as not to threaten the parishes and the city. It was set up a cumbersome joint committee of these local board bodies, although some of the vestries, the little parishes, were grouped together in so-called district boards for purposes of representation. The institution's name, Board of Works, was meant to suggest it wasn't a form of London-wide government. However, scandal engulfed the Board of Works towards the middle of the 1880s, and it was decided as part of a wider reform of local government in England to replace it with a directly elected London County Council. This is an important step, because the LCC was the first directly elected city-wide government for London. But once again, there was no reform of the city of parish vestries and district boards, which by this time had been joined by poor law boards as well, so the clutter of little institutions of different kinds and boards running public services, but now with the London County Council on top. Between 1888 and when the LCC was created, between 88, when the LCC was created, I'll read my writing here, and 1899, a process of reform took place which led to the creation of 28 metropolitan boroughs within the LCC area. So we're still inside Inner London now, but we're grouping together some of these parishes and district boards into metropolitan boroughs. These are smaller than the existing boroughs, but one of them is called Lambeth. And this is, you can see how we're getting building blocks here. We start with parishes and vestries and joint boards and district boards. They're joined together now into these metropolitan boroughs. Now, this is a big step. By 1888, of course, when the LCC was created, 10 years later these boroughs were created, the city had already grown beyond the inner London boundaries. Certainly in East Ham and West Ham, where Newham is today, these areas were largely built up, as there were extensions from Lambeth south into Croydon. There were large settlements around the northwest fringe in boroughs like today's Brent or Wilsdon, as it then was. So from this point onwards, particularly between 1918 and 1939, the city grew at an astounding rate, because there were no planning restrictions. Elizabeth I couldn't succeed, but nor did anybody at this point. So farmers were selling their land at great speed all the way up the Northern Line, down to Morden on the Northern Line, and what happened is huge housing estates, public and private, were built at great speed in this period, and London grew enormously to the massive urban thing it had become by 1939. The Underground played a role in this. The Underground bought out land and built tube lines along it and then sold the land to housing developers. So there was an enormous jump, partly encouraged by the tube. And this is where this led to an area of 650 square miles of city. That was the biggest city the world had ever known at that point. The counties of Kent and Surrey and Hertfordshire and Essex became increasingly urbanised at the London edge. Middlesex was entirely built up in the northwest of London, to the northwest of London. And within these counties, of course, district local government was largely provided by municipal boroughs and urban districts. East Ham, West Ham and Croydon were all-purpose county boroughs. They run everything in their area. And we then see from the 1920s onwards that there are arguments for a new greater London council. What we need is something that covers the whole of this province, something called the province of houses. So So this is, it's a massive area. And academics, particularly at my own institution, the LSE, a professor called William Robson, predecessor in the role I hold, he argued for a London-wide government, the Greater London Council, or Greater London Authority, as he called it. And it took about 30 years to get from the position where a government felt reform was sufficiently important to take direct action. We have to roll forward now to 1957. Harold Macmillan is by now just Prime Minister, and his government announced that a Royal Commission would be set up to consider the question of a possible reform of local government inside this much wider Greater London area. Chaired by a city solicitor, Sir Edwin Herbert, and it considered an area even bigger than today's Greater London. So places like Harlow and Crawley would have been in this area. It's a massive area for review. Herbert reported in 1960 and proposed the creation of what he called a Council for Greater London. That would be a bit like Transport for London, as a name. Council for Greater London, with 51 boroughs, with populations between 100,000 and a quarter of a million. And he argued that the borough was to be the primary unit of local government in Greater London, which has got the beginning of the bottom heavy bit here. The scale of the operations of the borough, in Herbert's words, must be big enough to attract first-rate people, both as councillors and officials. And the resources of the borough must be sufficient to support the full range of borough services. So it followed that many of the then existing boroughs would have to be reorganised into bigger units. The City of London, of course, was different. The Herbert Commission dryly noted that, and this is a direct quote from the report, logic has its limits, and the position of the city lies outside them. So Herbert, and indeed the government, proposed to retain the city and give it all the powers of one of the new boroughs, plus a number which were unique to it. For example, it's got its own police force. Now, some of the Herbert boroughs, the ones that were proposed initially, like Newham and Merton and Harrow, exist today. Went all the way through from those proposals to today. But most didn't get past this Royal Commission stage, and what happened is that we then go forward to argy-bargy in Parliament, when MPs and the local areas are arguing for and against different configurations. Imagine if we did it today, and I'll come back to this in a moment. So, for example, at one point, Finsbury, Hobart and Shoreditch were going to be in a single local authority together. They were three of the pre-existing authorities, bits of which are today in Islington, Camden and Hackney, respectively. Though at one point, Shoreditch was actually going to be in Tower Hamlets. Now, there were places like Banstead, and Epsom and Ewell, and Esher, and Walton and Weybridge, all in Surrey, which were inside the original London, managed to negotiate their way out, which is why if you look at Kingston upon Thames in the London map today, there's a little peninsula sticking into Surrey because the places on either side of it that might have been in London managed to get themselves taken out. Now, in fact, we didn't end up with 51 boroughs, we ended up with only 32. Some of the 51 proposed authorities included former district councils in what is today Outer London, whose status would be much enhanced when they were liberated from their county council. So if you were in Ilford, which went into Redbridge, you suddenly escaped the clutches of Essex County Council and began to run your own services. That was important for Ilford, because Ilford was bigger than most of the London boroughs, even though it was outside London. It had its own tram system. So it suddenly could run its own services, and that's what they wanted. Within the LCC, now inner London, Conservative boroughs such as Kensington, Chelsea and Westminster were enthusiastic about the proposed reforms. That's because they wanted to get out from under the yoke of the permanently Labour-controlled London County Council. Most Labour boroughs opposed the proposals, except Fulham and Hackney, which supported them. Not that oddly, actually. The London County Council opposed its own abolition, and many Labour boroughs within London supported them. Labour accused the Conservatives, and not without reason, of wanting to expand London and thus bringing in a number of affluent suburbs, making it more likely the Conservatives would win control of the new Greater London Council authority than the LCC. The LCC had been permanently Labour controlled since 1934. In 1961, the government published its own proposals, partly based on the Royal Commission, and they wanted to call the new Metropolitan Authority the Greater London Council. The minister proposed there should be fewer, larger boroughs, and that education would be run by the boroughs alone, except within the London County Council area, where a single authority would take control. So Herbert has suggested, and heaven knows what this would have been like, making education a joint responsibility of the GLC and the boroughs. By this point, the government is proposing 34 boroughs, not 51, but as I said a moment ago, we'll eventually come down to 32. Now, as the debate about the white paper continued, government consultation continued, under pressure from outer London district, outer districts, gradually a number of places were ruled out of being inside Greater London. And this is the point when Banstead, Caterham, Morlingham, Morton, Weybridge, and Esher all get out, as were Chesham, Staines, and Sunbury on the Thames, Chesham, of course, to the north. Parts of Hornchurch and Surbiton were also taken out. So, of course, places leaving London, and of course, it's one of those interesting things about cities. People who live in the middle of them are very proud of the city generally, like to think of themselves as Londoners. But people who choose to move out, and many people in these districts have chosen to move out, not that enthusiastic about being brought back into the city. And you can see why they might think like that. They've decided to go for suburban or rural life, and here is a royal commission or a government stretching out the boundary, so you're back in London again. So you can see why people think differently than when you live. So, in a different version of history, of course, we'd have had different boroughs. So Lambeth and Southwark would have been one of the new boroughs. The old Lambeth and the old Southwark. Southwark was a small borough, the previous borough, They'd have been a single borough. Camberwell, including Bermondsey and Deptford, would have been another of the new London boroughs. Lewisham, we've had no Deptford, of course, in those, if that had happened, and no riverfront. So it is remarkable how one period's modest administrative tidying up, that's all decisions about which bits of the previous system go together to make the new boroughs, become the basis of another's day-to-day government, the system we have today. So the London government bill, finally introducing what the government wanted to do, was introduced in November 1962. It was pushed through by Conservative MPs and opposed by Labour. There were lengthy debates about the powers to be given to the GLC and the boroughs, but there were also many proposed amendments about the precise configuration of the new boroughs. Any decision about the components of one borough had knock-on consequences like knocking over dominoes for all its neighbours. To make things even more difficult, the outer boundary of London was always being negotiated. In the end, as I said, there were 32 boroughs and not 34 or 51. The City of London lived on once again. And the question choosing names came up. Now, I haven't got enough time to do this today, but there were some absolutely spectacular efforts to come up with names. Let me give you one from Camden. Camden brought together Hampstead and St Pancras, Conservative Hampstead, Labour St Pancras, and Marginal Holborn. And some bright spark thought, well, let's have a name that includes bits of all three. So Born Democrats was one of the names supposed. And I think Barnet at one point was going to be called Northern Heights. I think in Lambeth and places south of the river it was generally easier. But the other thing, of course, is that many of the boroughs wanted to have "and" in their names. So in order to preserve several places that say Wilsdon and Wembley, let's call ourselves X plus Y. Wilson and Wembley were not keen on joining each other on my own. Sir Keith Joseph, who was the minister at the time, would have none of this and refused to allow any boroughs to get put an "and" in their name, except one. Who can guess which one got an "and"? Kensington and Chelsea. Now, it's true that at a later date, Barking and Dagenham and Hammersmith and Fulham got an "and", but in the initial groupings, in beginning in 1985, just Kensington and Chelsea. And this brings us forward to the 1st of April 1965, only 50 years to go. We've done, not doing too badly, we've done 1,950 so far, so not so far to go. New boroughs started their work. Some decisions were taken at this time which have consequences which are clearly visible today in the city's streets. Let me just give you an example. A very good example, which even though it isn't in Lambeth, is one we will all know. That is, the city of Westminster, over the river, commissioned a new nameplate. Okay, the nameplate. You might think, well, what's in a nameplate? Actually, most of us can, in a mind's eye view, imagine what the city of Westminster definitive nameplate is. It's been copied all over the world. And in fact, it's almost as much as a signifier as London today as red buses and phone boxes and black taxis, you know, conventional London cabs. So so that's the kind of decision which Westminster, other boroughs made their own decision. They just use that one as an example. It was a Russian design, a man called Misha Black, who also designed Victoria Line trains. And the city of Westminster signs that you see today, and much copied today, date from this early period, and it's a brilliant design decision by Westminster Council. All of us had to decide that they came together, because you know, Lambeth was bringing together itself and other pre-existing authorities, but they all were, had to decide where to put their town hall. Now, Lambeth was in Brixton, fair enough. But elsewhere, it was much more complicated. Some places built new buildings altogether, famously Kensington and Chelsea, and Hillingdon, Bill Hillingdon lives in a kind of massive brick chateau, which is a wonderful building in many ways. Very controversial when the then Labour leader proposed to build it, but today a remarkable piece of architecture. But it did matter. The place that was chosen to locate the main town hall, colleagues of mine researched this, developed more than places that were left. So if you were in a borough where there were two or three boroughs coming together and one of them got the main town hall, that place is tended, I'm not saying in every case, tended to do better economically than the places that were left behind. And the obvious reason is, of course, all the councillors, all the officers go in and out of the town hall and look at it every day, whereas the place that used to have a town hall is less true. So it's important where the town hall is located. Now, in the early years of the new councils, there was much enthusiasm within particularly inner boroughs to clear slums and to build new housing estates. It's hard to exaggerate, and I had to look this all up for a book I'm writing about this, hard to exaggerate just how dreadful housing conditions were in the early 1960s and before. There were evil landlords, we call them evil, Brackenism in North Kensington and North Westminster, landlord so bad it's given a neighbour word to our dictionary. And anyway, much of the housing, whether or not it was run by bad landlords, was also lacking in things like baths, toilets, and running water. Even, this is as recent as 50 years ago. We talked about this in the early 60s. Boroughs like Lambeth and Southwark and Hackney had significant numbers of housing. Of homes where they were privately rented generally with very, very poor conditions. So there was a sort of desire, not only to reform London government, but more generally to improve the quality of housing and, as I'll say in a moment, to build roads. So all the boroughs appointed borough architects to oversee the design of major developments. And many of these architects had trained at the Radical Architectural Association, which is over in Bloomsbury, which was notable for training radical and innovative architects who were very taken by the theories of the Bauhaus and Le Corbusier. These were modernist architects who wanted to use architecture to deliver social change. Many had worked with a man called Sir Leslie Martin at the London County Council Architects Department. So Lambeth appointed a man called Tom Hollenby and Ted, sorry, thank you for that, Ted Hollenby, thank you, copy my writing, and Camden Sidney Cook. These architects believed in the capacity of well-designed buildings to change the lives of Londoners who had hitherto often lived in slum condition. You have to remember this. So in Lambeth, George Finch, an architect, designed Lambeth Towers, Cotton Gardens, and Brixton Rec. Lambeth Towers came complete with community facilities such as a doctor's surgery, nursery, and older people's centre. This development is still in use, not far from here, in fact, and broadly functions as planned. So it's not to say that, you know, it's easy. I'm going to be rude about 60s architecture and architects, but this example worked relatively well. Camden, which pursued a rather different policy, they had a different policy, and a borough architect called, planner called Sidney Cook, they became a byword for low-rise, high-quality modern architecture. Developments famously such as the Alexandra Road development, which is a long curved thing that you can see the back of as you go out of the Euston, out on the Euston main line still there today, still popular, still relatively successful. But many other council housing developments have proved less successful. Indeed, many have been constructed and knocked down during the life of the London boroughs. For example, and I'm not picking on particular boroughs here, there isn't one in Lambeth, we happen to hear. The Ferrier Estate in Kidbrook, which is in Greenwich, and the notorious, I think I can call it that, Holly Street Estate in Hackney, have been entirely redeveloped since their construction in the early years of the new boroughs. Just think about that. They were built during the life of the boroughs, completely knocked down and completely replaced. And there are plenty more like this, and there are boroughs all over London even today who are still coping with the baleful consequences of council housing estates built during the 60s and early 70s. Poor quality construction, brutalist architecture, ill-thought-out layout, cost-cutting, changes in residents' lifestyle were among the explanations put forward as to how idealistic public housing turned, in many cases, into a nightmare of broken lifts, boarded-up flats, poverty and social disorder. Now, you know, we're not far from an area where massive redevelopment is taking place today. Aylesbury and Haygate Estates, I mean, they're not in Lambeth, but they are in Southwark. They clearly impact very much on people's lives locally. And you know, simply deconstructing why they were built, good reasons, how they were built, not enough money to maintain them. And the progress now of having to replace them and how to do that when the government, all governments, not just this one, doesn't provide enough money, is worthy of a book in itself. Any one of these complicated stories is worthy. And I found one I was looking at, again, I'm not picking on this borough because they're a good borough, Waltham Forest, where a terrace of houses where there'd been a lot of protest from local people about knocking them down to build a big estate in the late 1960s. They were knocked down, big housing estate built, Cattle Estate, that proved unsuccessful, it's been knocked down, and now there are terraced houses there this year. Now, you know, it's not the council's fault, we're all to some extent to blame, and many of the people who were involved in delivering this housing did it because they believed it was good, and indeed the housing was so poor, they were right to think something needed to be done, and we've learned from this, we've learned a lot. A leading indicator of the need for change was famously provided by Roman Point in Newham. Roman Point was a 22-storey system-built block. It had been built with chunks of concrete bolted together very quickly. It was a way of building housing quickly and cheaply. And on the 16th of May 1968, soon after its construction, a gas explosion in a flat caused the entire corner right the way down the building to collapse, just concertinaed down. If you Google it, it's a shocking picture. Amazingly, only four people were killed, partly because it was the early morning, somebody got up to put a kettle on to boil water, it's that kind of early morning. So many people were not in the kitchens, but if it had happened at 6 o'clock in the evening, I need to say no more. And this signaled really an end to this particular phase in the provision of social housing. Now, were the London boroughs and the GLC, who were also coming to the start, to blame for the failures of the 60s and the 70s, these housing failures? I think with the benefit of hindsight, it's easy to see why concrete slab blocks, elevated walkways and isolated towers would be problematic. I think it is easy to see it now. Idealistic architects cannot have predicted the kinds of social change that occurred from the late 1960s onwards. And it's absolutely clear to me that councils were attempting to clear what they saw as time-expired older housing and to provide council tenants with decent, spacious homes and inside facilities and central heating. And for a brief while, it worked. I found wonderful, in researching for this book, I know, what a wonderful GLC film made in 1967 in which an elderly lady is interviewed and she says, I think moving into this, she describes how she used to have to go downstairs to get water and to go to the loo, and how now she's got hot water, a nice view, and she says, I think this place saved my life. I feel like a princess. And that's for just a brief period when it worked, for about 1967-68, and then Roman Point collapsed, and subsequently all the problems we know so well. So I'm trying to be fair in analysing how this happened, but it is very important. Now, other activities of the GLC and their friends in Whitehall provoked much borough opposition. So we've done housing, briefly. The early years of the borough saw a number of boroughs having to fight the GLC, which wanted to build an enormous motorway box, the so-called ringway system. Most boroughs didn't want it. By far the easiest way of understanding just how this happened much less in South London than north of the river. But anybody who knows and ever used the Westway, which carves evenly through the north part of Westminster, Kensington and Chelsea, and then tapers off into northern Hammersmith and Fulham along the red boundaries. If you look at photographs, you can get these easily on the internet as well. It just carved through a Berlin Wall, but worse, cutting through communities, destroying, people were left with their windows looking out over a motorway. And the boroughs, much to their credit, almost entirely fought the GLC over these things and eventually turned the tide. But it took a number of years to turn the tide against massive road building. Chunks of the motorway box can still be seen if you want to go and visit it. Not actually interesting, the Westway wasn't really part of the motorway box, but you can see the West Cross route. Anybody who's been to Westfield at Shepherd's Bush, that chunk of motorway there, or the East Cross route, Bow Flyover, that's another piece of it. There are bits of it here and there, chunks of the North Circular, and indeed, of course, the whole of the N25, which was built by stealth, with bits here and there and then linked together. So London was in the end spared most of all of this, but largely because of the efforts of boroughs representing local communities that fought back after some of the worst excesses of road building. But as I say, South London, and there are always jokes about the South Circular, I remember a series of back streets linked by traffic signs, as I remember people used to describe the South Circular. But you have to say, if you look at the North Circular, where some people have houses where they have to back their cars out onto a three-lane motorway. I'm not sure the South Circular not being built wasn't better than the North Circular being built, personally, but that's just a personal view. So, housing rents took an enormous amount of time and energy of the early boroughs. And paradoxically, this modernisation of the city took place at a time when its population industrial base was in sharp decline. Between 1965, the first day of the boroughs, and 1980, the Greater London population fell from just under 8 million to 6.8 million. So it fell very sharply indeed, a rate of reduction almost as fast as the increase is today in the opposite direction. London found itself facing rapid decline. Peak hour tube and rail travel to central London began to fall, or the government policies had kind of encouraged this. And this allowed the government to cut back on investment in the underground and other elements of the transport system. And it's this period of underinvestment that's been a problem for the capital and its train and railway systems, tube systems ever since. And the economic decline of London and other cities had consequences for industrial relations and for politics. In 1968, the Conservatives swept to power in every single London borough, hard to believe this these days, except Barking, Newham, Southwark and Tower Hamlets. So every other borough was Conservative controlled in that year, and that had the interesting effect of sweeping out of power lots of old, and some of them were not being ageist here, but they were geographically old, we're all getting on, and also old, kind of old labour. Very different form of labour, and I'm not insulting anybody in the room who likes to think of themselves as old labour, but they were swept out. So people like, now guess who gets elected in Lambeth? John Major gets elected. This is the time when John Major is elected to the council, the housing chair, much praised by Ken Livingstone, no less a personage, as somebody who swept some of the racist policies of the old council out, and started to have a more fairer way of allocating housing. What Livingstone says of John Major, who am I to disagree? That's his analysis. But what he also did was to bring new kinds of Labour councillors into London politics in 1971, when the Tories fell back a long way, Labour surged forward. So a completely new kind of set of politicians appear in London. And this is very, very important, because boroughs such as Camden, Hackney, Islington, Brent, Haringey, Southwark, Greenwich and Lambeth found themselves with new forms of Labour councillors, and in Lambeth a significant number on the council. Many of them adopted radical policies, including decentralised subcommittees and the defence of services from cuts. This is Thatcher's government was in power in the early 80s, and now we're defending ourselves from Labour. Boroughs are defending themselves from cuts. And I picked out a quote from London Labour Briefing. Anybody remember London Labour Briefing? Which was the, of course, this form of politics is being pulled back before our eyes, or at least the people, some of the people involved in it, as we speak. The London Labour Briefing was the sort of news sheet of the new left in London politics. And reading this quote, it just takes you back to the time and gives us a sense of why Jeremy Corbyn's election is such a fascinating thing. And I quote from London Labour Briefing. One of our hopes for decentralisation of council services should be that it will help develop a political awareness among more people that the struggles of council workers and the community over cuts in jobs and services are a common anti-capitalist struggle against economic oppression. But this is the mindset, this is the view of radical Labour councillors on councils such as Lambeth, but not only on Lambeth, at the time. And there was, in response to rate capping, efforts were made by boroughs, including Lambeth, to work together to refuse to set a rate, a tactic that it was believed would force the government to backtrack the cuts which were being imposed by Mrs. Thatcher and her Environment Secretary Michael Heseltine. Eventually, opposition to rate capping collapsed. One of the last people to want it to collapse was, of course, the Shadow Chancellor, John McDonnell, at County Hall, intriguingly. And one by one, the boroughs found ways of justifying setting the rate or allowing opposition councillors to set one. Most councillors didn't want to risk surcharge and bankruptcy at the hands of the district auditor. Of course, it was exactly that, surcharge and bankruptcy at the hands of the district auditor, which affected a number of both Lambeth and Liverpool councillors. It wasn't only the Labour Party that was radical in the 80s. In neighbouring Wandsworth, radical Conservatives, and in Westminster, radical Conservatives appeared. Famously in Wandsworth, a small council, small state, very sort of pragmatic, common sense, different kind of Conservatives. And over in Westminster, soon enough, Dame Shirley Porter, with all of that brought with it for the Conservatives in Westminster. Now, policies pursued in boroughs like Lambeth by radical new left councils include a number of causes, such as race equality, women's and gay rights, which have subsequently become mainstream across all parties in local and national government. It's worth remembering that. Equal opportunities, as such, were born at this time and stimulated the national media into a frenzied attack on the so-called, and I've got it written down here in quotes, loony left. Progressive councillors, in fairness to them, and you can see this today, progressive councillors from this group were running ahead of public opinion, but might today reasonably claim to have been proved right in content, if not in process. You know, we have a Conservative Prime Minister who's just championed same-sex marriage. Now, if Labour councillors had done that in the 80s, it would have been considered loony. But today, it's considered mainstream politics. So that's how things can change. And on matters of race equality as well, there's been an absolutely dramatic turnaround, which these councillors, to some extent, were in the vanguard of pushing out the idea of those ideas. However, many of the same authorities, that's the nice thing I'm going to say about them, the less nice thing is this, many of the same authorities and councillors confused a more liberal attitude to people and rights with an over-relaxed attitude to good management and an unwillingness to tackle failure, which undermined the quality of services, leading to the breakdown of some boroughs' housing, refuse collection and benefit services. And there are some pretty baleful stories at the time about how poor the services for council tenants in particular became in a number of boroughs that were being run by these same authorities. Now, it wasn't all Mrs. Thatcher's fault. It's naive to say that. It was simply that management didn't work. And so it took authorities like Lambeth and Hackney a number of years to get a grip on their services again and to drive them up to the point that the Audit Commission, now abolished, was saying that their services were among the best in the country. Other boroughs in London were untouched by all this radicalism and ideology. Here in Lambeth, or over in Westminster, or in Wandsworth, or Southwark, it was all radicalism, left or right. But in Croydon, it's never like that. I mean, that is a compliment. Croydon has moderate Labour councillors and moderate Conservative councillors who some lose, some gain, it's a bit more Labour now than it used to be, but there's no ideology in Croydon or Sutton or Hillingdon or Havering or Bexley or Barnet or Bromley, or Betty Bromley, but Barking and Dagenham, good people call me, Barking and Dagenham, definitely none in Barkham. Barking and Dagenham has a kind of politics that, you know, it doesn't really exist in any other borough, changing now, but it's very, very old Labour, and so on. Redbridge, Waltham Forest, Labour or Conservative, all of this passed them by. So there's a number of boroughs, particularly in inner London, where these ideological wars took place. Now, of course, the ideological turmoil of the 70s and 80s created conditions where the GLC, established along with the boroughs in 1965, was abolished. Bromley councillors, in particular, led the charge to get rid of the GLC. And within 3 years of Mrs. Thatcher's government's original announcement, the GLC was to be scrapped. It was gone. Shocking to most people in most countries. We don't have a constitution in Britain, so Parliament can just vote out of office other elected authorities. It's very difficult to do that in America or Germany, for example, or anywhere with a constitution. The boroughs and the city inherited many of the GLC's responsibilities. A new committee of boroughs took over the fire brigade and other things such as citywide planning and so on. Then, a few years later, the IDA, the Inner London Education Authority, was abolished, and boroughs like Lambeth became their own education authorities for the first time ever. First time Lambeth or its predecessor authorities had ever run education. And of course, as we get to the end of the 80s, a big further demographic change happens. The city's economy turns round and starts to grow again. And although I haven't been able to go into this story in as much detail as I should have done, London had seen successive waves of migration from 1948 with the arrival of the Empire Windrush at Tilbury, and again in the 70s when the British government took East African Asians into London. Of course, Lambeth profoundly influenced ever since by the arrival of people from the Caribbean. Boroughs like Harrow affected by the arrival of East African Asians in the 70s, and again in the by the time we get to the 1990s, we've just got the edge of another big increase in immigration. To add to the fact the population has turned around from its low point of 6.6 million actually, in 1985, and starts to grow sharply again. Now, boroughs like Lambeth from now on, under what I've written is aggressively moderate leadership, appointed new chief executives with the explicit purpose of bringing about radical improvements to housing, street services, and tax collection. Southwark similarly moved on from a period of complex collective leadership, that's a euphemism really, to the rebuilding of good government. Hackney required briefly a Conservative Labour joint administration to begin the process of service improvement. But from this point on, the London boroughs, which had been affected by the struggles of the 70s and 80s, moved on to become among the best run of all local government in England, as measured, as I said a moment ago, by audit commission rankings. The next step in the evolution of London government, of course, was Tony Blair's election and the recreation of London-wide government in the shape of a mayor and assembly in 2000. One of the mayor's most important roles was to a requirement to create a London plan, which both Ken Livingstone and Boris Johnson used to set out a path for London's rapid growth. I remember going to a seminar just in the run-up to the GLA being created with an American mayor from Denver, and I remember him saying, you must remember, this was before we had a directly elected mayor, he said, directly elected mayor, we've got to stand on a tall point of that city or town hall and look out, and they'll judge how successful they are by the number of things they can see being built. And of course, once you get directly elected mayors, be they Labour or Conservative, it was independent briefly, whether it's Steve Kahn or Zach Goldsmith, they will want to see things being built. And indeed, we need things to be built, given how fast the population is now rising. It's rising at 120,000 a year as fast as at any time in the city's history, even in that rapid spurt of growth between the wars. Now, boroughs are different. Some of them favour a low-rise version of the city. You go to Bromley or even to Westminster, not much enthusiasm for tall buildings. But if you go to Tower Hamlets, partly because of the legacy of the London Docklands Development Corporation, but it's actually both, it's been mayoral policy under Lord Raman before he left office, is to go up and to build huge new buildings. And actually, it's probably the right thing to do, in fairness to him, because by doing that, he's housed many more people, and he's been able to, the Tower Hamlets and other boroughs, Southwark and Lambeth are doing something similar, are able to use the resources they gain from these developments to build more social and affordable housing than they would otherwise be able to do if the government alone funded it. This is one of these terrible challenges for inner London boroughs, that if they build lots of big new blocks of flats, they get more money for social and affordable housing. So there's a sort of Faustian deal here, which is very complicated to work through and very hard for most of us to understand. But I think, inevitably, the boroughs are on balance doing the right thing. Now, writing a decade after the boroughs starting work, so in the mid-70s, Simon Jenkins, who writes for The Guardian, previously editor of the Evening Standard, wrote, and I quote, "All the institutions set up in the capital in the reforms of 1964-5, the most successful have been the new London boroughs. While the GLC and Whitehall bureaucrats bickered and battled their way from one strategic stalemate to another, the boroughs were quietly making the best of their new powers. The rapidity with which they established an identity of their own was remarkable. Local government in London is borough government." So that was in 1975. About 16 years after that, a colleague of mine, now retired from LSE, went to work at University College, Michael Hebert, concluded, and again I quote, "The borough effect is a straightforward expression of political geography. And you think about Lambeth or Southwark, wherever you live, when I'm saying this, because he's absolutely right. The borough effect is a straightforward expression of political geography. The units created by the reconstruction of 1965 had a new territoriality, distinct from their predecessors, and competitive with their neighbours. Each arbitrary tract of built-up London, defined in the reorganisation process, became for each borough leader and their officers a field of vision, of expectation and action. Original marriages of administrative convenience became real entities, worth campaigning for, with boundaries that showed on council wall maps like an island shoreline." Now think of the number of documents you've seen from your local borough, whichever one it is, which just shows the borough like an island. And how right Michael Hebert was in identifying this phenomenon. That's perfectly sensible. And in fact, it has further consequences, which have been studied by academics, not by me, which is, you know, other things being equal, you'll tend to put your councillors, I'm not saying this is true here, by the way, but generally, you know, you'll put your libraries near the middle of the borough where most people will see them, and if you have to have a waste munching plant, you try to put that on the edge. And if you won't really have to say it. Now, I'm not saying that's happened here, but it does happen. And borough boundaries are very interesting places, that's all I'll say. Now, London in 2015 is far more affluent and in many ways a more settled place than in 1965. The makeup of its population has changed enormously, though actually, London has gone from struggling with the orderly management of decline to a need to accommodate a population growth of 100 to 120,000 a year. And throughout the whole of this period, the 32 boroughs and the city have swept the streets, emptied the bins, planned development and housed the homeless. There have been good times and bad, but after 50 years it is possible to look back and analyse what we've learned. I think the first thing is it's a miracle the boroughs have lasted 50 years, and that's a miracle anything the government lasts 50 years in Britain, given the propensity of British governments to meddle and reorganise. As I say, the GLC only survived 21, and the IDA just 25. Second, an ideological war of all against all is not good for the people or government of a city. The years from 1975 to 1990 were bad in many parts of London, even if the reactions to them have been moderation and pragmatism since the end of those struggles. The difference between Mrs. Thatcher's government and the New Left in London can be explained by changes to the city's industrial base and its population, but the results were not good for tenants in particular, I would argue, or for council staff, or indeed for the reputation of London and its government. Third, London government's good for recovering from serious problems. You look back over hundreds of years and make this observation. It's good at recovering. That's partly a tribute to the people who live here, are resilient, we are resilient, all of us. But the boroughs have mostly managed to continue through good times and bad, contraction and expansion, and continue to operate effectively. Fourth, history suggests that large developments and redevelopments are probably better handled carefully by a joint initiative involving both the boroughs and communities and the private sector. I think the big comprehensive developments of the 60s and 70s didn't work. I don't think any borough tries them these days. What you're left with is something where the community has more of a voice than was true then, but where the private sector and its expertise is far more used than in the past. And then, fifthly, the bottom-heavy two-tier system that I mentioned at the beginning is probably a good one to run a large city. Now, not everybody agrees with this, but it's my personal view. I'm nearly finished. A two-level system, I think in a city the size of London, imagining having a refuse collection disposal system or a planning department for 8.5 million people, I suspect would not be very efficient. Just imagine ringing it up. And then you think maybe bad enough ringing any town hall up, and imagine ringing one for 8.5 million people. So the bottom-heavy two-tier system does allow us a local voice, but it also gives us a metropolitan voice. And in fairness to all the politicians involved, we, the voters, we the people who live here and work here, have different needs. On the one hand, we want quiet around our homes, we want peace, good schools, proper clean streets, street lighting, and all of that. But we also need trains and buses and roads and all the other hard infrastructure. But we don't want it too near our home, but we want it just near our home. And the whole business of the struggle between citywide government and local politics, I think, is in sorting out those conflicts. And actually, a two-level system is quite good at doing that. So, the two-tier system is now an established norm for London. Apart from the little period when the GLC didn't exist, it's been a two-level system since 1855. So I think we can say, even by British standards, that's quite a long time. And I think that the geographical scale of London is such that a single government would inevitably be seen as too big and too distant. The much-defended borough level would be too small to deliver a cheap system. Yeah, we know that. So it's a compromise. Now, does the system need further reform? Some voices in recent years have suggested there are too many boroughs, or the mayor should be given greater power over the boroughs, or boroughs should be fragmented into urban parishes. There is indeed one urban parish in Queen's Park in North Westminster, and perhaps we need more than that. I mean, again, my personal view is that the issue of whether or not there are too many or too few boroughs needs to be seen against the backdrop, both the costs and benefits of potential reforms. Reorganisations cost money, nobody can ever prove they save money. Anybody who works in the NHS will know that. And the boroughs are quite big by the standards of municipalities in other countries. We may think that Lambeth, with 250,000 to 300,000 people, or Croydon, with nearly 350,000 to 400,000 people, seem a bit small. But actually, these are among the biggest municipalities in the world. There are very few countries with councils as big as our London boroughs or our metropolitan districts or our county councils. So these are quite large anyway. So personally, I think the boroughs are probably just about the right size. And anyway, I'm not sure reorganisation is ever a particularly good idea. On the other hand, it may be possible that as the city grows fast, that the balance of power between the boroughs and the mayor may need to be changed. As London becomes a city of 9 and then 10 million people, and that's what the projections show, it will from time to time be necessary for the mayor to drive through developments that boroughs don't want. This is highly controversial and can be very, very difficult. But we do need more housing. We do need more housing. And in local areas, people will often resist it, and I can see why they do. But occasionally the mayor will have to assert the need for it. And you know, if you listen to the mayoral candidates, both Sadiq Khan, well, Conservatives don't have one now, but if he were any of the Conservative candidates who have come forward, they're all talking about 50,000 homes a year being built, which is more than double the number we did this year. So for every struggle there is now, there'll be twice as much struggle. So I'm not saying that's not the right policy, actually, I think it is the right policy, but it will imply the mayor more often than in the past overruling the boroughs, which is never popular with local, with those of us who, wherever we live, locally. For the time being, the relationships between the boroughs, the city and the mayor, are broadly harmonious. Partnership of the mayor and the boroughs is important in meeting both the pressure on budgets and the infrastructure needs of the city in the coming years. There is a question about devolution to London. Should we be like Scotland and Wales? We won't miss can of worms at this time of night. Should London become more of a free state? Should it try to get more independence for itself? You could certainly argue that London, which is on a number of indicators different to every other region of the country. I always like looking at charts where London, if you look at all regions of the United Kingdom, where London's on one side of the axis and all the other regions are on the other side, there's quite a number like that. London is a very different place. It's still a British city, but it undoubtedly has a population makeup that is radically different to those of the rest of the UK. So that issue, I think, will run and run, particularly against the backdrop of Scottish devolution, oblique, near independence. So finally, as London grows, its population can capture the benefits of development for the improvement of the lives of its people. That's the only way it's going to happen. It's not going to be a huge amount of public money around it in the coming years, so we need to use development in London to help ensure that local areas improve, but that local communities have a voice in the way this development takes place. The boroughs are well placed to do that. And as we look ahead to the likely future of the boroughs, whether they'll continue to provide the services they have in the past, I think the answer is they will continue to provide a fragmented, flexible, competitive, and collaborative. So think of those words. Fragmented, flexible, competitive, and collaborative. So they do collaborate, but they compete. And that's very interesting to remember that. You look at all these towers going up, there's an element both of competition about it and a sort of mild collaboration. And it's very interesting to see how this works in real time. So, my final thought, 50 years is a long time, but not so long in the life of London government, not so long in the life of London. And the city where the Corporation of London has survived 1,000 years, or very nearly 1,000 years, then 50 years is short. But for most people, any children born since the 60s, anybody born since the 60s, it's the only form of government they've seen. So, all I'd say is, happy birthday, London Boroughs. Happy birthday, everybody here who lives in the London Boroughs. I'm guessing there's most of you, and thank you very much.
I'll just pick up on one thing that Tony said, which was, I quote, the borders of boroughs are interesting places. And as some of you know, by the little chuckle bunty, the border between London and Suffolk is that road there, which makes this a very interesting place, as I think we've heard this evening. So thank you very much indeed, Tony. I think we've got time for a few questions and answers. So, if you would like to pose Tony a question, make it difficult, please, you're the professor. Then put your hands up and a roving mic's coming round.
Who do you think was the more effective leader, Herbert Morrison or Ken Livingstone?
Great question. I think Herbert Morrison led the LCC from 1934 to 1940 before he joined the war cabinet. And I think the truth is that the powers available to the LCC in that period were vastly greater, or significantly greater, than the powers available to the GLA and to Ken Livingstone. So, in a sense, you know, Morrison was an incredibly powerful, moderating, old Labour figure. And I think, and you know, they ran the regime of County Hall by all accounts very tightly. And I think that Morrison had a very clear vision, his view of how a city should work, how a political party and group should work. And in that sense, I think you'd have to say Morrison, but I'm not being disparaging to Ken Livingstone. It's simply that, you know, Livingstone had to use far more powers of the authority and the dignity of the office, particularly when he was the mayor. The great thing about Livingstone, Ken Livingstone, is he was leader of the GLC for 5 years and then mayor for 8. So no, it's hard to believe anybody will ever leave London for as long. But you know, the struggles of the 80s were distracted everybody from running the city, I would argue. You can say that's Mrs. Thatcher's fault or Ken Livingstone's fault, depending on your taste, but certainly it distracted them from actually running London. And as mayor, I think Livingstone put the mayoralty together and did a great job. And of course, paradoxically, in the context of the debate we've seen in the last few days about Jeremy Corbyn et al., actually Ken Livingstone as mayor was as pro-development and business as anybody you could imagine, very different to Livingstone of the 80s. So, hard to answer, but I'd probably just about give it to Herbert Morrison because he had more power, because the office was more powerful. The LCC built Waterloo Bridge, after all, even though the government tried to stop them. Nobody could do that anymore today. You couldn't do that today. I can't be building, but I should hardly mention the garden bridge.
Yes,
you do. Will you touch that? No, I'm not going to mention it. Thanks, great question.
Thank you very much, Professor Travers, for covering so much ground in just 70 minutes. That's been very, very good.
Nice to do it on 60, it's kind of easy.
Well, I think you did a very good job. Very nice and concise and clear. I actually live in Croydon. This is a town that features in a book called 50 Crack Towns. I think they're going to try and make it the crappiest town. But also lived in Germany. Now, Germany, as you know, most of its cities, there's only three exceptions, I think, München and Berlin, they're of the order of 600,000, 800,000. That seems to be a good model. I'm surprised, in fact, there seems to be no desire to try and push out a lot of activities from London. The transport system can't cope. They're both Ken Livingstone and Boris Johnson said they want more firms and more workers coming in. The transport can't cope. I can only assume they're just wind and done in the front, and in fact by developers. Now the other thing, I want you connected with
this. I think it's more personal than that, but I'll explain. Yeah,
yes.
Good point.
Social psychologists comment that the best committees comprise between 5 and 7 people. But you have absolute powers vested, in fact, in mayors, and it's proposed, I think, Manchester should have one. And nobody, we've seen this in the evidence of this in London, nobody in fact can master all the intricacies of economic arguments and understand balance sheets and the rest of it. Do you not think that this is a bad development, that so much power should be vested in one individual? This has nothing to do with the personalities of Boris Johnson or Ken Livingstone. It's the idea of getting a democratic and probably more efficient outcome if you have a smaller committee of say between 5 to 7 people in the lack of psychological studies that have been made on group meetings and their effectiveness.
Okay, I mean, on the first point, I think that the right about why, given what Ken Livingstone and Boris Johnson, the policies they pursue, that I don't think it's for the wine and dining reason. I just think it's because the thing I was trying to hint at with the American mayor, which is that you're mayor of a city, you just want to be as big as it possibly can. I can't, if you, it's just the kind of thing, if you're the sort of presidential figure who wants to be mayor, and then you become mayor, and then you ask yourself, would you rather be, you know, mayor of a city whose population is going up or down? You'd say up, I think. Most people would say up. And in fact, the fact the city is, I mean, how many times do we hear, and I'd do it if I were him, for Boris Johnson saying, the city of London, 100,000, 110,000 a year or whatever it is. And Ken used to say exactly the same. They like the idea of being the mayor of a big, growing city. And certainly you'd rather be that than the mayor of a rapidly declining city. So, and, you know, the policy is, why not thin it out, which I think was the thing. I think that was tried. I mean, Croydon, after all, is the product of trying to thin it out. The reason Croydon has its Manhattan skyline is that it benefited from efforts to constrain office building in central London in the 1960s, particularly after George Brown became Minister for the Department of Economic Affairs, I think there was. And businesses that couldn't build offices, in fact, there were two effects. One is it drove up rentals in central London, something rotten, and it pushed businesses out, not to the north, where the government hoped it would go, but to Croydon. And Croydon Corporation took advantage of this to build all those what are now time-expired offices along Wellesley Road. In fairness to Croydon Corporation, it's not their fault because it all happened at once, and now of course it's all the same age at once. It's a lesson for us all. This, you have a mixture of buildings of different ages, so they don't all get to 50 years old at the same time. So they're now having to replace them. So I think it's more that mayors just want to be in, they want to be the leader of a big growing city. And as to the, would a committee of five or seven be better? Well, it might, but as you will have heard from what I've said already, I'm kind of mildly antipathetic to reforms of any kind, because I think they're displacement activity, and there's a problem with us, so it's worth reforming. Well, why not find out what the problem is and sort the problem out rather than reform it? And I'm not saying you're saying that, by the way. The truth is that Tony Blair and David Cameron, presidential prime ministers both, George Osborne as chancellor, presidential ditto, like the idea of presidential figures in local government. And that's the truth. They like it, they like the idea of ringing up somebody in Manchester, talking to somebody, rather than ringing up 10 people in Manchester and talking to them, 33 in London, one is easier for them. So I think that we are now not going to retreat from directly elected mayors, remembering that all 33 authorities in London voted for the mayor, even Bromley, touch and go in Bromley, but they did. And 51 to 49, or 52 or 53 to 47 years. So I think that, I can see the arguments for a more collective leadership, but I personally was a supporter, supporter of the idea of a directly elected mayor, because it does give London a figurehead, and it's quite, given how disparate the boroughs are, having a simple city-wide government, it's true there's one mayor, but there's 1,800 councillors in the borough, quite spread power. So I think the system's all right, personally, but we agree to disagree, we all have our views. Many, many wise people think we shouldn't have a mayor, we should have something else, including some of my dearest colleagues.
Can I take one or two more? Not to be rude, follow up afterwards, so we can take two or three other questions. So, you're in charge. I'll make it short. I completely agree with you on the point of reorganisation. But there is a major problem with housing in London. The cost of housing, the lack of social housing, affordable housing. If you were mayor, what would you do working with the local authorities to solve that? And is there any legislative change that would help, or any other changes that would help, or are there things that can be done within the current structure?
Again, it's all great questions. I'm not an expert in housing. I have wonderful colleagues who are, and I go to a lot of their events. There are so many reasons why we don't build housing that I'm still not sure I know. Oh, I'm so sorry. That sounds very kind of you to remind me. Thank you for that. Very good. Clearly, we must always remember that the problem is one of supply. We need more supply. So I'm very subsidising building. I've never thought it was a particularly good idea. And I am not convinced that, that's false. So But I don't know what the answer is. I don't think necessarily building on the green belt is an answer. Some people would like to do that. And it would be a very quick way of producing huge amounts of housing, rather as in the 1920s and 30s. I suspect that the one thing I think that would make it easier is if people near developments were given slightly greater compensation for the disruption as the development took place. I think that it's very hard on people who are affected by developments not to react against them, even though they know that we need more housing. But they also know they don't want disruption for years of trucks and noise and drilling and dust and all of that. And so I think people who are affected, and this will be true of tenants, by the way, who are moved out and moved back if they're lucky, need to be rewarded for the wear and tear of the development. That would make it easier to get developments through. Because there's all sorts of opposition to development. I'm not sure the planning system is necessarily one of them, except that councils will respond to NIMBY pressures where there are. I'm just whittering the answer. I don't know the answer. Don't know what the answer is. But I think it does lie in giving Londoners and councils an incentive to build. I think there has to be an incentive for areas and people who live in them and for councils to deliver more housing.
I think it is the key question though. I think Ken Livingstone in particular did a great job on transport, but the mayor coming in, the really key issue is planning and housing.
Yeah.
To ensure that the city is livable in and workable in for the population, we don't end up just with no housing, no affordable and social housing in the centre.
Even people in the property industry, because they know that this tarnishes their reputation, nobody disagrees. It's one of those issues where virtually everybody agrees on what the problem is, and indeed what the... But going back to the thing I said earlier, I think the challenge that we face is that there's a lot of complaints about the number of people from overseas buying housing to store cash, and I can see that. But even that does release resources for social and affordable housing, so even that's not quite, if it stopped, if nobody from overseas ever bought a house in London again, it would just mean there was less social and affordable housing. So it's a complicated conundrum, really complicated. That's because, new developments subsidise new social and affordable housing. So I agree with you, it's a problem, but I don't have a solution, I'm afraid. Right, I'm going to look back, I had a hand up some time ago.
Thank you very much. We need to say sort of about the 50th birthday of the Boroughs.
Yeah.
Something that you touched on about how it's crazy, but not really wasn't too much since, is the outer boundary raised on the. You said about things saying static. That is one of the remarkable things that has stayed static in those 50 years. I just wondered, the 2011 census was the first one ever in British history whereby all of the district councils around Greater London, more than 50% of the resident population work within Greater London. With Crossrail and the Overground sinking its tentacles out into outside of Greater London, is it time that these places got some political representation for the services that they're using? But also, is it the time that they're paying some London council taxes for the services they're using?
I'm sure they'd like one, but not the other. It's a good question, and indeed, Transport for London, I think it will, A, definitely has the power to, but I think has appointed members from outside London onto its board. So there's a hint in the direction of the point you're making. I think some parts of the Overground, which TfL's taken over, run outside London, up to Chessingham, for example. I think people outside London, they like the concessionary travel and the electric cars, but I don't think they want to be run from City Hall. Right? They'd rather be run from Hartford or Maidstone or wherever. So I think. I think there might be an argument for looking at the outer boundary. And there may be some You know, there are boroughs like Dartford and Slough, which I think were probably, I can't speak on their behalf, can I, but probably a bit more suggestible than, because there are benefits, there are benefits to living in London, there are definite benefits, not least of which is concessionary travel, which is a big issue on the border. But more than that, they might benefit in terms of planning, being built into new transport systems, and so on. And they often have a bit of land which would be useful too for development. So there are good, but I think many of the others just wouldn't want it. And you'd end up exactly as happened in 1963-4-5 with, you know, parts of Surrey trying hard not to be brought into London. They like to be thought of as in Surrey or in, you know, Hertfordshire used to be Middlesex up in the, that area. So, but it's certainly something that I think will probably eventually have to be looked at, given that certainly my economic geographer colleagues would not see London as 8.6 million people in Greater London. They'd see it as 15 or 18 or even 20 million people who can, you know, get to central London within an hour and a half, which of course nowadays includes people living Bradford soon, people in high-speed tubes that are built. People in Manchester will be in that position. So, and vice versa, you might say, if you're standing in Manchester. So I think it's an interesting question, but I doubt anybody's going to revisit it. They've got enough battles to fight anyway, but it's a good question.
It's a bit of an emotional question about brothers. Because when you talk to old people about burdens,
yeah,
and step, yeah, all these, you know, holders and so on, and segments, they really used to love the place. And you know, for years we've been moaned about being part of these big anonymous boroughs. So what would your advice be to the 32 London boroughs now? How can they become loved in the same way?
Yes, Mike had it to us, I mentioned earlier, a beautiful book he wrote called London, More by Fortune Than Design, pointed out that if you look at road signs in London, and now I don't mean the street signs, I mean the green ones, almost all of the places referred to on them are pre-1965 London boroughs. So they point to Holloway and Bermondsey and Camberwell. They don't point, I rarely point, to Redbridge. I'm not sure you go. Redbridge is just, you know, they point to Wanstead or somewhere. So it's a good question, and I think it may be that, with the exception of Harrow, which was the only borough which didn't change any of its boundaries at all in 1965, so it's the same place, that something that happened in parallel with that reform and subsequently, which is something I consider a good thing for the avoidance of doubt. I mean, London becoming a much more international sort of city of people from not just Britain, all over Britain, but all over the world, means that our sense of community, I think, is a bit less geographical than it was in the days that ran up to those boroughs. So those boroughs, if you lived in Holloway, actually, with all our friends who lived in Holloway, or Stoke Newington, you'd probably, Battersea, to take one nearer to home, you'd probably, you know, identified with it, went to a market there, spent most of your life there, and so on. Today, whilst there are still people who spend most of their lives in the borough they live in, I guess more of them have come from somewhere else and move around more to different jobs. And, you know, if you look at all the jobs that were created on the Isle of Dogs, you know, many of those are done by people who live in St. John's Wood, you know. So the Jubilee Line moves people around along the South Bank here. So I think it's probably that those identities were formed at a time when London was more passport to Pimlico, which was made in Lambeth, of course, just up the road here. And you can still see it identifiably, actually, the Hercules Road and all of that. But so I think it's probably something to do with that. I haven't thought of it. It's really another cool question. I think it's something to do with that, and that the post-1965 boroughs bigger, and in a world where the population of London is radically different. best I can do. Well, if they last 1,000 years, we will be there, like the city of London, we all know the city. Then they have griffins, meeting with griffins standing on plinths to remind you where you're going to the city. That's what I think. Now, there's a chap over there.
I'll start while the microphone's on its way.
Okay.
You've been very nice to us so far, not to single out.
Which us is this?
Sorry.
Right, okay.
Not actually said anything that might discomfort your hosts, but I would like to ask, do you think that there is anything exceptional about Lambeth's history over the last 50 years as a modern borough? Or is it very middling? And if so, could you say what it is?
Well,
and a follow up to that is there has, in the first half of this borough's history, been a sort of a discomfortable marriage because of the way in which the borough was formed. I wonder if you think that there's anything unusual about the way the whole metropolitan borough of Wandsworth was torn asunder. It was unique, which I think could be for 30 years of discomfort as happened with Streatham, really felt like additions here. I'm just wondering if that's something which you can cross on that is a non-issue now.
I mean, there's no doubt that I've got a chunk in this lecture which I left out, really, about the beautiful section of a book written at the time about creating Lambeth, Wandsworth and Southwark and the struggle that went on to chop up Wandsworth in the right way, and Battersea wanted to go it alone and so on. And of course, once you change any of these things, everything else falls to bits. That was the problem. It's like redesigning parliamentary constituency. I mean, Lambeth, I think, there's no question Lambeth has a distinctive, the modern Lambeth, post-65 Lambeth, partly because of things that happened within it, which might have happened anyway, but they happened in Lambeth. So, Lambeth, Brixton, it's even, I haven't had time to talk about this in detail. There are books written about black British history. There's no question that Brixton and Lambeth, as the borough in which Brixton stands, is a hugely important part of modern British history for that reason, if no other. But it's also intriguing in that, Brixton and Stockwell are places that are also, I'm always fascinated, if you go talk in other cities about the way London works, particularly elsewhere in Europe, they're always rather surprised that areas like Brixton are also places which, where there's a sort of struggle about gentrification going on as well. So they are sort of complicated because Parisian suburbs, I'll go to Paris, are less mobile, less likely to be open to people moving in and out, pretty delicate thing. So I think that's interesting. I think the other thing about Lambeth, this is true of Southwark, Hackney, Islington, Camden as well, is that they were getting poor. They were really poor places in the late 60s and 70s. And they've gone. I mean, the very problem, the housing problem, is a fascinating one because these boroughs were emptying out, and my older colleagues were buying houses in Islington for £3,000 in the 1960s and early 70s because they were derelict, and the council was municipalising them, as I'm sure Lambeth was definitely, buying up street housing, with squatting, big squatting problems, And we've gone from that to a problem which boils down to there's too much money. I don't think there's too much money, but I mean, there's sort of the inequality between the people who can't get access to housing capital, or indeed housing, and everybody else, including myself in this, who are reasonably able to do that, has become more obvious, partly because the economic circumstances of boroughs like Lambeth have turned. I think Lambeth today is much better for not having a declining number of people living in it and a declining economy, but that's revealed other problems. But I do think the Lambeth story and the Southwark story and the Wandsworth and the Croydon story, each one is individually interesting, and they are separately interesting, even though there is an element of lines on maps about how they were created, but they're real places with their own real story. And of course, didn't mention Ted Knight by name, but Lambeth's political history in the 1980s and its subsequent recovery into being sort of the model postmodern Labour Council are themselves interesting stories. Two interesting stories. The one led to the other, I would argue. Forgive me if anybody I'm not seeing, you don't see the hand in there, gentlemen.
It's not possibly a specific London borough matter, but we hear that the UK compared to other countries is highly centralised in its governance. And I just wondered what your thoughts on how that patent centralisation affects London and changes in that patent centralisation in the last few years. Just what levels of discretion they really have.
Sorry,
Mr.
Travers, could you repeat the question? Lots of people
were I can, I will. The question was. Thank you for prompting me. The question was, Britain is very centralised, or England within the UK, is a very centralised country. How much power does a borough like that does really have, if I sort of summarise that? It's a great question, again, it's all great questions. I think that it is a very centralised, England is a preposterously centralised country. Lambeth Council, other councils up and down the country have no control over their own resources. And they have to get government agreement to do things that, frankly, in any other. The example I was giving of an academic colleague from America coming to the Houses of Parliament. This is for land, this bear with me on this. Discovering the House of Commons was discussing the width of cattle grids. Well, in no legislature in the known world would things like the width of cattle grids be a meat and right thing to be discussed in the House of Commons or in the main legislature. So we are a centralised country. However, and I generally think local governments should have more power, but it would be wrong to believe Lambeth and Southwark and Croydon and Wandsworth and other boroughs don't have enormous power over the world in which we live. Two examples. Every service you meet just outside your front door is run by the council, and if it's not done well, people complain, and rightly so. And some councils do it better than others, and you can tell. That's very, very important. Morley's opinion puzzling shows that if you ask people who has more, and I can lead you on this, if you ask people which of these organisations has more effect on your life, Parliament, the Cabinet, the council comes top. That's the first thing. But more obviously, I mentioned this in passing, look at the London skyline. London boroughs and planning systems. Different boroughs have very different approaches to planning, to tall buildings, to big buildings, to conservation and so on. And with this being the case, I think that the planning system, which is by far local government's most visibly effective power, is one that central government doesn't tower, which I think was John Prescott's decision, wasn't it? But generally they keep out of most planning decisions, and this is a hugely influential and important power that local government still has. It's not about money, it is about money for big developments, but it's the best of our lives. So I'd say that even though local government power over education, for example, is much reduced, its planning power in a place like that has never been more important. Go on, disagree with me. I like being a nice thing. I'm sorry, I don't want to pick up you, but as you were tutting, I go on.
Perhaps we've got time for just one more question. This is not related to the fact that the rugby was
well. Disagree with me.
I was just thinking with this present moment about Lambeth's problems on the Save South Bank, and it doesn't seem to be very powerful there. I want to make two observations, and they're both around housing because this is critical, it is central. On Wednesday, the programme at 8:45 is called Foresight. Barbara Weiss spoke about London and the high-rise buildings going up, and they contrast with the planning system in New York, an early one with high-rise buildings. And she is part of a trying to stop this renaissance, as is known. There's 260 plus things in the pipeline or being built at the moment, between 20 and 60 and 70 stories high. And they all, they don't sort of have any sort of homogeneity. They mean merely wanting to be iconic buildings with no housing for people who could, people who can't afford to buy rents or to stories. And that I would recommend as something to listen to. But the other thing about brutalism, and she made rather harsh comments about brutalism and said it agrees that the 60s, the 70s was poor housing. But open weekend, open house will have some of the brutalist buildings open, and they are very touristic.
Yeah.
They include the Alexander Way in sort of the Maid Vale area, which is a Camden project, I think. Lee Brown, the architect, is still alive.
Yes.
And then there's the Golden Golden Memory Estate, the architect. There are many places that are really well worth preserving.
Sure.
Modern building of high rise and housing.
and gives planning permission, I think that's it. The borough then has less control over what it gets out of the negotiations. So, that's one thing. On the brutalism front, I kind of half of, well, where to begin? There's no sensible, I can give no, I mean, brutalism, for and of itself, isn't always a failure. The trouble was that much of the concrete and glass, some of which was, some of which wasn't, brutalist architecture on social housing estates, got tangled up with other things that were nothing to do with its fault necessarily. So it's blamed for things that are not its fault. On the other hand, I think the entire political class at all levels of government in Britain has lost its nerve with ever housing people on middle to lower incomes again in big, tall buildings. They'll house owner-occupiers or affluent people in big, tall buildings, but they won't do it any ever again with people on lower incomes. And you can see this at the Elephant and Castle, where the big new towers are owner-occupied, I think. Some will correct if I got this wrong. Yeah, and nearby, there's lots of estates, new, nice-looking housing, which is lower-ish rise. Some of it houses, some of it small blocks, which is social and affordable, I think. And that model you can see in tower hamlets as well. So I think that you're right about the correct collective act of will, but I think that politicians at the national and local level, and the people in housing associations, just wouldn't risk it again. I think they honestly believe that having got it wrong before, what they want to offer people is something more recognisable as streets with houses, with gardens and low rises, and then pay for it with some of the big high rises bought by rich owner occupiers. Now, I know that's a very complicated story, but I think that's where we've ended up. We can talk about that.
Thank you. I'm sure this conversation could go on for much longer. Sandy has been closing down because we have to reset the room and stuff that's going on tomorrow morning. But if you can novel Tony afterwards, I'm sure you can novel all for a few more minutes. I mentioned at the beginning that there's a really interesting book about Morley. Did I say that? So again, before you leave, do have a quick look at it, and if you're interested, buy it. I also mentioned the fact that it cost you a penny to come in. I didn't mention how much it might cost you to get out. There is a collecting box at the back. If you've enjoyed this evening and would like to show your gratitude, the money goes towards our bursary fund, which helps more disadvantaged people be able to come and take our courses. So if you can, please put a few pennies, pounds, into the collecting box. And at the end of all that, we're just left to say thank you very much, Tony, for a really engaging, fascinating evening.